There you got it, Donald Byrd. That's your record. What's it called?
Change makes you want to hustle.
Makes you want to hustle. Hustle. Hi, welcome. Welcome to London. Welcome to England.
Thank you. It's a pleasure being back here.
And yeah, you're on the show early because you got to be working tonight, okay?
That's right.
Where's it you doing your thing?
At Dunstable.
Dunstable. So anybody, you realize what's going to happen now. I'm going to lose probably about 3,000 of my audience because they're all going to come running out there to see you play. Yeah, that's the man, Donald Byrd, and that was Kevin Tony.
Right. I'm glad to be here.
Ah, great. What part do you play in the Blackbyrds?
I play keyboards with the group.
Ah, you're the man with the nippy fingers. when the record's playing and Donald was sitting there, he was really listening to it. And all the time I can see his mind, he's criticizing it all the time. You still haven't finished producing that record, have
That's
you?
That's right.
You still listening to it. And I said, "Do you do it? Are you playing on the record?" And you said, "No, Donald won't let you play on it with him."
No, actually, I said he's not good enough to. It's because of contractual obligations. That's the only reason why.
Right. Can I, you know, something that Donald Byrd, your name has been around for a long time. And here in England, people have been talking to you for such a long, long while. You've been doing so many good things. But your style has changed now. Then you picked up on the Blackbyrds, and did you move them into the direction that they're in now, or did they have
We moved each other in the direction. I was greatly influenced by the students at the university where I used to be the chairman of the department. Mm. And we taught each other. And so with the success of the Blackbyrd album that I had a few years back, I decided to take some of the better students out and give them an opportunity to perform.
Right. The thing that amazes me about the things you've been doing with the Blackbyrds anyway is because you get this mellow pattern every now and then you get into a real funky bag sometimes, and sometimes you get the nearly erratic. I think with things like Rock Creek Park, you've sort of really gone in one direction, sort of way over there, and still managed to hold it in there in a very mellow and controlled mood.
Well, one of the things is that everyone in a group writes and they contribute. And on Rock Creek Park, that's actually a collective effort. So, like, you know, things go one way and the other, but as a producer, I try to bring about some type of consistency in the album concept. Mm-hmm. So that's why we might hear one thing one way, one another, you know. But it hangs together because actually they all think alike. And when they do an album, like even though it's diverse from the standpoint that each individual person is contributing, but the overall concept is still there. It hangs together, you know. It's still within a certain groove, certain framework.
Are you the disciplinary force within the
disciplinary, right.
Since both of you here, you and Kevin, I'm going to get a chance. I'm going to play this next record, which is Rock Creek Park, the one we've been talking about, to give him a chance to play his keyboards and let everybody hear how beautiful he can do his thing.
All right.
Okay, Rock Creek Park. Again, you've been looking at Donald. You've been looking. I can see your eyes moving. Aren't you ever satisfied with anything you do? Because again, I can hear you questioning.
No.
You're never satisfied.
No, I was really listening to the sound and the bass, and I was thinking about the Minnie Riperton.
Yeah.
And you know, like I'm sure, like. Even the members of the group, we listen very critically at a lot of things. Like, notice like the, say, like from Papa John's Creed. And, well, I was just thinking of the difference in the sound of a record that was made maybe 2 years ago or something like that. That today, you call it in the States, you say you try to make a record as hot as possible. Uh-huh. and get much presence. And you can hear the difference in things that everybody was producing even a year ago, because like now everything is into the disco sound because everybody's trying to get more physical. And as I've mentioned a couple times, that people don't realize that they're coming into body contact now. The people haven't touched one another in the last 20 years. That's true. Like with Chubby Checker, like he took us out.
Right, the twist.
Right. And now, like with the new hustle and so forth, people are beginning to touch one another. And I think the dance thing and the disco sound is going to bring about a complete change. And, of course, it's going to bring about a complete change in the recording.
I want to talk to Kevin right now. Where did Donald see you guys? And what happened that made him want to get involved?
In other words, how did the whole thing start? You mean with Donald Byrd and Blackbyrds? Well, all of us were students of his at Howard University, which is in Washington, D.C. And like he said earlier, he wanted to give some of what he thought his better students was a chance at making a living, you know, out of music and making it an ongoing thing as opposed to just being a classroom situation. And so he gave us our opportunity to record. And he gave us an opportunity to travel and just learn the professional end of the business.
And weren't you a little dubious about him because he was into sort of really heavy, let's be, if you want to use a phrase for it, Blue Note type jazz, like the record label that he's onto now?
Tell him what you thought when you first when I told you to get into the new thing.
No, I'll tell you, on the contrary, when I came to school, he was past that. I was where I thought he was. And he was where I should have been. If you can dig that.
Right.
So it was a thing where we each caught up with each other and we formed what we have now.
When you heard that you had yourselves a hit record in England, out of the field, was it important at all to you or Donald or the rest of the band?
Sure, because we're interested in reaching all people all over the world, not only in America.
It was a sense of accomplishment, right? Definitely. And I think it gave them greater confidence in doing the new album, like Rock Creek Park.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it goes back to an old educational principle that the more pluses you get, the more positive and more assurance that you get.
Right. But, you know, that mellow thing of walking the rhythm, the simplicity of it, it always reminded me of, you know, okay, so it's a love song in many ways, right? But it always reminded me of a little boy walking through the park. You know, he's left home and for the afternoon because he can't take all the heavy trip that's happening there.
Right.
And he don't want to go play with his friends. And, you know, and he's just walking. He's got his hands in his pocket. And
right.
And it has that kind of simplicity to it, too.
Right.
And that's the reason why I love it, myself personally, anyway. I mean, when it actually became a hit here, I was knocked out for everybody, you know, because, you know, basically what was happening here in England, if it was not basically pop soul, it never saw the light of day on the radio.
Right.
You know, and you did pretty good. Let's have a listen to that again. But I've got to remember what it sounded like.